to Contourcast. My name's Kat Boyd. This is David Jameson.
How's it going? Slow on the draw as always.
No, but also my patter is pretty rusty because it has been some weeks since we got together to do a recording of the pod.
Indeed it has, yeah.
I think it's just work. You've got two jobs, I've worked full time.
Indeed, and we're recording this late at night.
Yeah, it is actually late at night. It's been a long day for me, which is why I look and sound a bit bedraggled by the world. Was through in Edinburgh today for the first time since the 1st of March.
Mm-hmm. I've had a long day as well. I haven't had dinner yet, partly because I wanted to stay skinny and beautiful for this podcast.
You can't pod on a full stomach.
No, because then you're in the food coma.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I did go out for a delicious Vietnamese meal.
Mm.
So funny considering our conversation earlier about your experience of toilets in Vietnam.
Yes. Traveller, the one thing you need to know about Vietnam is, we were talking about Alan Partridge, who has a podcast out, his toilet technique for not touching anything in a public
which
toilet.
I used today on the ScotRail Glasgow to Edinburgh train. Where I use the passenger toilets without touching any surface, simply using a effective and sophisticated combination of elbows and feet whilst the train was moving and in high heels. You know, like real, like elbow the button, lift the lid up with your foot, hover. The works.
Yeah. I mean, I've been perfecting that stuff for years. I haven't touched the door handle in a very long time. Of any kind, not just to a public toilet. Like, I don't touch door handles in my own flat.
True?
I'm not sure, to be honest. I say that, but I think it's probably more when I'm out and about. I mean, one thing I do a lot is I have a pocket handy. So you'll often see me turning a door handle with it.
I have witnessed that. I thought you were just lazy.
You can't be bothered taking my hand out of my pockets.
Yeah.
I mean, I usually use a sleeve or a pocket to open the door.
I mean, now that the virus is very much with us and possibly with us for the long term, I am a fan of the long sleeve. The long sleeve to cover right down over your hand, then you simply are able to turn the door handle or push the door. Also, like, I'm a bit of a fan of the old shoulder into the door.
Yeah. So this is why I'm glad that summer will soon be behind us. Because I've been going out in short sleeves, right? And the door to my close, there's a little turny thing. I mean, you can't just do it. I'll let you go full on turn and pull, right? But that is, like, the most anti-social distancing measure. Because everyone's touching that.
Yeah, do you know what I mean? What about the other thing I do now is I carry a hanky, a packet of hankies, like, in my pocket. Yeah. And whenever I come across a situation such as the one that you've outlined, especially if I'm using, like, the toilet in a restaurant or something, do you know what I mean? And it's got, like, a fidgety lock, then I will use a hanky, which I can then safely dispose of later.
Yeah. And wrap it inside out so it's not touching anything else.
Exactly.
Because then you got to start thinking about cross-contamination.
Totally. Like, what you don't want to do is just spread the germs around.
Yeah.
Got to be very careful.
Yeah. Anyway, so we're back in local lockdown.
Yeah.
So-called.
It was good while it lasted.
Mm-hmm. And local lockdown in Glasgow means that you can meet as many people as you want so long as you're spending money while you're doing it. COVID-19, one of the interesting features about the virus is that it doesn't spread in areas where people are exchanging money for goods and services.
Well, this is what I find particularly interesting about the coronavirus is that as long as you are paying to be somewhere, it won't get you. Or as long as you're being maybe exploited at work, then you can't catch coronavirus.
Absolutely. It's at its most dangerous when you're spending the least money. if, for example, you're in your own house, that's when you're very
with your friends and family. Like, that's when you're actually very much in danger.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So a few days after the Glasgow local lockdown was announced, there were restrictions newly lifted on nightclubs, because there's no way in which in a nightclub, you know, the virus could spread.
Sort of. I mean,
this is the thing about, yeah, bars.
Yeah, so the plan for nightclubs, as I understand it, now, I would definitely put nightclubs up there with things I miss. Like, I miss being in the dark, having, like, being surrounded by noise, like, dancing. Like, I do miss that, like, really immersive experience. But as I understand it, the plan for reopening nightclubs is to turn them into pubs.
Mm.
Thus, they are not nightclubs. Also, they will have the lights on. Now, having had the very unfortunate experience of witnessing nightclubs in my hospitality days with the lights on, that is a sight that, frankly, no one wants to see. It's like, it's the hospitality or entertainment industry equivalent of in American crime shows, you know, when they go into a room with like the big glow light to detect blood and semen.
Yeah, yeah.
In a nightclub in Glasgow, all you need to do is just turn the fucking lights on.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, this is not an experience that anybody wants to enjoy.
It's been a lot. It's probably been a number of years since I've been in a nightclub, but I always remember that point at the end of the night when they turn the lights on and you can suddenly see the destruction and the sort of bewildered people blinking, looking a bit tragic, hunting around for someone to, you know, shack up with.
Or their jacket.
Yeah.
Whilst their jaw goes in one direction and their body in another.
Yeah.
That's a classic look.
Awful. So that is going to be a new kind of, yeah, drinking experience. You're just going to sit at the bar in a nightclub with the lights on in a big empty hall, drinking a pint that costs like £8 or something, a wee bottle of beer that cost £8. I don't see it. But in any case, this has been done at the behest of the kind of nightclubs lobby in Glasgow. At precisely the same time when we're not allowed to be engaging in this sort of famous Roman orgies we were all doing. This is the other thing that's emerged. It's all been spread by these kind of super spreader parties
Everyone in Glasgow has been having house parties. I will tell you, it has been mayhem in my street. There has been a house party every night and thousands of people up and down the street, music blaring. I mean, nothing of the sort. Not a fucking whisper.
No, I know. I've not heard.
All I can hear is like seagulls. Like, that's it. Just seagulls.
Seagulls are taking over. We both live in tenement flats, right? You can hear a night, a party in a tenement flat in the whole street. I don't know what it is about the construction of tenement, because they're all conjoined. You can hear one a flat over.
If you're on the same block as a flat that's having a party, you will hear it. Because all the flats were originally joined together. Did you know this? So see where the wall press is?
In
the book cupboard.
Thing. Yeah, the little
like that cupboard was actually for construction workers to be able to walk through the whole block without having to go like downstairs, along, up, and makes sense.
So
I mean, you can also people open the windows because folk are smoking, and it just like the noise just echoes about, doesn't it?
Yeah, so I think it's fucking bollocks. The seagulls have taken over in the absence of, you know, during when lockdown actually meant that and there was no one in the streets, right? Which is a fucking mad thing to remember. I remember you could walk up on your one-a-day walk up to the top of the hill at Queen's Park behind me and the city was silent. Like, that sound of the cars in the background, there was nothing.
Yeah.
That was a very strange moment. But during that time, the seagulls took over, but a very strange new society has arrived to seagull kind. Because I kind of thought when I emerged, why are they so big? why are they so aggressive, right? I've heard lots of reports of people being attacked by seagulls, and I thought, well, they're attacking you for food, right? Because they're starving. But then they're fucking massive and they're aggressive. So what's happened? I think I know what's happened. I think that the when lockdown happened, all the chips and the Alka Pops and the crisps and the shit they were living on, right, evaporated. And this precipitated like a Malthusian catastrophe, right, in the seagull population. The weak were, you know, started to die off and were eaten by the alpha seagulls. And so as we emerge from lockdown, we confront a new kind of super cannibal gull. And this is what's causing all the gull-related problems. That's my theory.
I think that it's as good a theory as you can't catch coronavirus in a nightclub, pub or workplace. It's as good a theory as that.
Yeah.
We've got another wildlife problem on Wildlife Hour with Cat Boyd. And we've got an infestation of squirrels.
Mm.
Squirrels everywhere. Canny move for squirrels. They're everywhere.
Why has that happened?
I don't know. Like, I think it might be, you know, the during lockdown when people would go their 1 hour walk, they'd often go to the park or down to the river where there are a lot of squirrels, but maybe feed them. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. As a bit of light entertainment. I mean, back in those dark lockdown days, there wasn't really anything to do apart from Zoom and take part in like quizzes on Zoom. I remember that was the fad for a while.
Mm-hmm.
So in order to get some relief from the Zoom quiz doom, I think people maybe like thought they'd, you know, throw some crisps to the squirrels. Now they are everywhere.
Hmm, interesting. There's also a superabundance of rats in Queen's Park. Huge rats.
You sure they're not just squirrels?
They could be the cannibal squirrels, sort of degenerated.
It could be.
So, yeah, but I genuinely do think, well, I say wildlife, the vermin life of Glasgow has changed. Like, the things that are feeding off us have been impacted by the various.
I mean, that's the very ecosystem of a city, isn't it?
Yeah. All these kind of various species of parasite that we've developed. Around it.
So the lockdown that we have right now, so we've got local lockdowns and got Glasgow, West Dumbartonshire, which I think is like fourth worst for corona in the UK right now.
Mm-hmm.
Renfrewshire, East Dumbartonshire, where else is there? I'm sure there's other places.
Yeah, I think most of these cases, and it is about, is it around about 100 cases? I know.
East Wren, I think, is the other one.
Yeah, it's sort of the greater Glasgow area. Well, I'd be interested in why that is. I mean, it might be a slightly older population or something. I'm not sure. But
well, I think that part of it's to do with jobs as well. Do you know what I mean? Like, and also that type of local lockdown where you can only really spend time with people outside of your like household beyond like a partner and an extended household is to go to a pub or a restaurant or somewhere where you're spending money, like in areas where there are like more people in poverty. Like, I mean, what are people going to do? They're not going to go to a restaurant when it opens. They're going to have pals round. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's a way to like, do you know what I mean? See your friends, have money, like enough to go around, do you know what I mean? Get food or whatever. Do you know what I mean? I think that that's what people do. So to ban that and say you can only socialize with people if you are essentially paying for it, it's a class thing.
Yeah.
In West Dumbartonshire, for example.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's kind of what I assumed. But it's, I don't know, it's a mad situation because in the middle of all this, like, everyone once again has forgotten about the economy, which, because, I mean, the wider context to this is that in England, cases are really sharply increasing again.
Yeah.
Like, the lack of stability in the economy and the sort of precariousness of the situation is just wreaking havoc. It's really strange. Like, the last few weeks we've had the Times insist people get back into their much-valued commute and all this kind of stuff, right? And right at that moment, there's another upsurge in the virus. Like, it's so strange that that is still, that whole debate is being suspended in the background. The economy is a mess.
This is, like, it's, I think, trash. Like, what this, the pandemic exposes is the precariousness of our mode of production. Like, our current economic system cannot emerge from this crisis, like, until there's a cure. Like, and but what this proves is that capitalism is deeply unstable and unsustainable, because the two choices right now that you have are that you either A, lock down the economy again, right? Try and hold it down, pause it. You're not trying to move money, right? Everything is like, hold it, right? Close everything. People work from home. There's no money circulating in the economy, which has already caused the recession that we're in. You know, there's projections of 300,000 people in Scotland being unemployed, furlough is ending, all of that. That's a disaster. Or you choose the other option, which is, some people are going to get sick, some people are going to die. And this is from, like, a kind of capital interest point of view. These are your two options, either lockdown or we have to keep the economy going, everybody back to work, back on the commute, make sure those five Pret a Manger's on your way to the office don't go out of business. But then the at least half, if not more, of your workforce. And, like, I think of, like, the workforce as the goose that lays the golden egg. Like, it is the workforce that is producing the wealth that makes the economy go round. Half, at least, of them, if not more, are going to get sick. So how do you run an economy when your workforce is ill? And some of them very, very ill. Like, it's just not possible.
I think the wider fear as well is that, you know, the herd immunity argument is a real thing, right? Could capitalist society accept a minority of its population becoming very sick or dying off and explain that away? Possibly. But I think that there's a deeper fear, which is that, see, if there was a really sudden spike in cases because you just said, oh, fuck this, send everyone back to work to save the economy, you might find that they create, it would create, like, a public panic. And people would just, even millions of people who didn't need to, would refuse to participate anyway. I think that is also a major fear. I think it's like they are conscious of needing mass, mass public acceptance of the general program of the pandemic moment, basically. I think they're afraid of damaging that, especially because they need that kind of public consent over a longer period. Let's say a vaccine is found for the virus next spring, say, right? Because it was supposed to happen, like, now, and it hasn't, right? Let's say it happens next spring. That's the end of nothing, right? I mean, we're then into years of economic pain. So I suspect that there are calculations about public psychology being made as well. But yes, definitely, like, how just fucking... It also makes me, as a, I'm not learned enough to know the answers to this question, but to what extent is, like, British capitalism just a particularly decayed, decadent, shit form of capitalism that you could only possibly get in one of the few metropolitan centres in the world system, right? Where so much of the population works in these fucking pointless offices that are just there to discipline the workforce and to return investment to construction firms and landlords and stuff like that in these huge office blocks. And then around the office blocks, there's two dozen Costa coffees and three dozen Pret a Manger's and the fucking stinking Burger King that's full of jams and and Wetherspoons and all that kind of shit, right? I can't believe just how central to the British economy that stuff is. Services, transport into the office, the profit that the office, you know, buildings themselves make for financial interests, landlords, construction firms, etc., etc. Like, it is a big bullshit circulation. I know that there's like this daft thing of like, there's sometimes this belief that the only way an economy is a real economy is if it's like producing commodities, like widgets and cars and shit. But leave that kind of stuff aside. It's still fucking ludicrous just how important it was that we were all traveling from like our home environment sitting at a laptop or a computer to an office environment sitting at a laptop or a computer. How much depended on that? How much depended on that commute of about, I don't know, 20 million kind of middle earners? You know, middle and higher earners. So much was dependent on that shit. Yeah, it seems feeble.
God, that makes me feel really depressed. Just instantly, really quite bummed out.
It's also that just this kind of weird thing of like, when I think of the heroic phase of capitalism, I think of something like Fordism. And it's not heroic. Again, I'm like projecting qualities on it of row after row after row of conveyor belt. Do you know what I mean? Churning out disciplines, soul-destroying capitalist activity. The image of, you know what I mean, all these tatty offices surrounded by a collection of chain pubs and cafes. That's the other thing, like, caffeine in the morning, booze when you clock off. Caffeine in the morning, booze when you clock off. That, like, chemical regulation of office labour is so important to British capitalism. Keep the people going with the stimulant in the day.
Get them depressed at night.
That is mad. I mean, that is not the heroic phase of capitalism.
Yeah, I mean, I find it absurd that you've got the business lobby doing the let's get people back to work, you know, to save the high street and the outlets on the commute and dry cleaners and all these sorts of things. Because the reality is that nothing's going to be the same. Like, we can't just put this back in the box. Do you know what I mean? And once this pandemic is over, this is going to become a fact of life.
Yeah, the other thing is, like, so many high streets are just going to be fucking dead. And it's not even the fact that people's shopping habits have changed. Like, Amazon as a fact of modern capitalism has changed.
Yeah.
Like, the scale of monopolization in the sale and transportation of goods, the retail sector, but also like the warehousing sector has totally changed the shape of the consumer economy.
Yeah. But what I think Amazon as a huge monopoly shows is that you can actually have a planned economy in such a way that doesn't suffer from the shortages of information that have plagued planned economies and led to shortages in the past. Like, there is actually ways of having a high degree of economic planning where nobody would, you know, be in want, that everybody could have a share. All of that is possible with the current technology that we have. And Amazon shows that, do you know?
Absolutely. And also, like, how responsive and effective distribution networks are.
Yeah.
Like, we live in a city where in Greater Glasgow, something like a quarter of people are disabled, right? It's incredible how effective those supply networks could be used to overcome access problems and stuff like that. It doesn't solve all those problems, but you see what I mean. I mean, do you know one of the companies which has done the best out of crisis in the UK is Farm Foods, because everyone's stocking up their freezers. So in the last couple of months, they've brought on like 3,000 more drivers like that, a fleet of new vans and all this kind of shit to distribute frozen foods at high speed because people are preparing for the second wave.
And for Brexit.
Oh, yeah, of course, for
Brexit. People are like, I've had two people in the last week tell me to get myself to the supermarket for some tins.
Brexit's back. It's back. It's back after a long and welcome hiatus.
It was nice to have a rest.
Yeah. Because as soon as it came back, I was like, oh, fuck, like, my Twitter account's going to have to go back to sort of slagging left off.
Yeah, it's going to have to go full gammon again.
I mean, so in the last week, it's fucking nuts. It is all of a sudden like nothing else has happened in the last, you know, 9 months or whatever it's been, right? So Boris Johnson said that he might, you know, change clauses in the Brexit agreement. And all of a sudden, everyone snapped right back. Everyone snapped right back to being a Remainiac or a Leaver who just wants it over. That whole discourse was rapidly reanimated. And it found, this moment found the left with even less to say about the situation. I can't believe it. Of course I can believe it. Keir Starmer's in charge now, right? Yeah. So, I mean, Labour's not going to have a better position on this. Keir Starmer failed to say literally anything on Brexit until yesterday. Yesterday was his first public pronouncement on anything really Brexit related. And his message now is just get it done, right? That's how terrified, obviously, of the issue he is. The SNP have gone from mad to totally bonkers, right? Do you know, there's an easy line in journalism in Scotland for anyone who wants to point out repeatedly, week by week, how fucking mental the SNP's various contortions over economic policy are becoming. I say that as someone who actually fulfills that niche. Right? And it is fucking easy, right?
So the main one that I can think of is old Mr. SNP councillor Freeports.
Fuck me. So... right, after all that shit about, you know, about how, about the Tories and, you know, how they're going to introduce us to this kind of new free trade regime. It's not shit. I mean, that is real. That is what they plan to do. Deregulating, you know, what we're going to end up with.
Chlorinated chicken
and fucking green milk or whatever it is, right? After all that, they go and sign up for the most insane Friedmanite, mm-hmm. wild, wacky, ultra free market position that the government's come up with at all in this entire period. Freeports. And they want to put one in Dundee. It's just fucking mental, man. So the local Dundee City Council, and this is Yes City that's having this idea inflicted on them, by the way. Who's thinking up this shit? He is going along with, I think it's Fourth Ports who control trade and Fourth, and they want to be one of these 10 free ports that the Tories are setting up around the UK. And Dundee City Council, following the well-trodden path of the SNP leadership over these last few years, whatever business says is good, right? You cannot fucking turn away Fourth Ports of all people. Around from this fucking crazy, experimental, like right-wing, libertarian, economic madness. So on the one hand, Freeport's good, right? But I'll tell you what's not good. The Tory plans to use state aid to improve UK tech industry, right? So Freeport's, that's good, that's very good. State aid, which might tear us out of alignment with the European Union, who have all kinds of controls on state aid, the use of state aid, that's bad. I mean, like, it's fucking crazy.
Yeah, but I feel like there's a sense of that SNP, or that we've known, come to know, especially over the term of the last parliament, like, I feel like the centre like central command are losing their grip on a lot of their people. Like,
yes,
I feel that there is a kind of politicians at loads of levels, activists at different levels are running away with themselves. Like, definitely, as the central command would see it, like people run away from themselves, deviating from the line. I mean, of course, again, there was a beautiful spat between a friend of the pod, George Kerevan, and our favourite SNP MP, Stuart MacDonald, over the Scottish Navy claims on Twitter. You know, there's a lot of this kind of people within the party openly disagreeing with each other, which isn't something that we've seen over the last parliament until really this year, I would say, is the kind of peak of that.
Mm-hmm. That's an absence of leadership, right? So that's absolutely true. I mean, it would be interesting to be a fly on the wall in conversations now between Dundee City Council and the Scottish Government. Like, I don't know what's going on there. At the same time as that was going on, so that Stuart MacDonald row is interesting because he went away to the UK Defence Journal where he was interviewed, which is, like, you know, like a pro, like an establishment, the establishment UK Defence Journal, and made all kinds of fucking nuts promises about what an independent Scotland would do in terms of defence policy, with wild projections about what kind of armaments we would use and all this kind of stuff. Unilaterally signed an independent Scotland up to all kinds of alliances, including mutual defence agreements with the European Union, which you wouldn't know to listen to any kind of ultra-Remain type that we have mutual military agreements within as part of the European Union, and which are connected to NATO, of course, as though those two things could ever be separated. And there's this great bit in the interview for this, for the journal, where he says he's sort of enthusing about how tightly bound in members are to the mutual defence agreements in the European Union. And he says something like, they're even more binding than NATO. I love that. I love this enthusiasm. We're even more bound to do bad things. It's fucking brilliant. This is amazing, right? I love that after the bombing of Libya by NATO, yeah, even more bound.
Isn't it wonderful?
We'll like have no eyes. Choice. Yeah. No democracy at all. No sovereignty. You thought you were bound into NATO craziness? Do you know what I mean? We're still sending kids to Afghanistan, right? You thought that was bad? Like, you've got no idea. We're gonna have no democracy at all. It's gonna be fucking great. But also in that article, this is a weird one. Chris McElhaney, who is the leader of the SNP group in Inverclyde Council, and he's trying to replace some SNP hack, right, in the Scottish Parliament. He's also a former GMB activist, and I don't know if these things are related. He, in the UK Defence Journal, made the first open kind of declaration, as far as I know, from an SNP figure, that we wouldn't get rid of Trident immediately after independence, that we would hold on to it until a solution could be found.
I mean, this does not surprise me at all. Like, I think that there is a big school of thought within the SNP, potentially within the wider pro-independence, I mean, not movement as such. I think there's still a very strong anti-Trident aspect to the movement. But, you know, when it comes to the real politic, I think that, you know, people will be like, oh, well, you know, the sensible thing to do is to use it as a bargaining chip.
Yeah. This
like,
is
a- no, Kat, what you don't understand is that it's leverage, you know, for us to get what we want from Westminster. Shut up, you bore, right? Like, I have had that sketch in my life so many times.
Yeah, I know. So years of the sage wisdom about how you can use your most sacred principles as bargaining chips. I mean, like,
that's gone really, really well in the past.
I know. But it's also like, I'm not taking any advice on negotiating from people who spent the last 2 years saying that any referendum should have a confirmatory referendum. Do you know what I mean?
100%.
You people know fucking nothing about how to negotiate like the exit of a country from the UK.
And
by the way, all that stuff's starting to crop up now. So there are articles, I mean, Alistair Darling, for the last leader, of course, of Better Together, is now advocating this. Well, you can have a referendum once we've agreed the deal, right? Which is very clever. And I'm not saying that that's going to be the mainstream Tory policy. I think that the Tories, I imagine, have got another plain no in it. But I think if they're ever forced to concede another independence referendum, we're looking at that type of scenario. They're going to say, okay, you can have another referendum, but it's three options on the ballot because we settled independence. Or, okay, you can have an independence referendum, but there are X, Y, Z conditions that you leave under. And those conditions will be designed to make it fucking terrible. Do you know what I mean? So the SNP have already opened us up to the worst possible, the SNP leadership, I should say, have opened us up to the worst possible negotiating hand. I'm not going to be won over by the genius suggestion that we prove to everyone in the independence movement that we don't believe in shit by suddenly deciding that it's good to use huge chunks of explosive nuclear material as bargaining chips.
Well, I mean, or we could go down the route of the workers' bomb.
The workers' bomb, yeah.
Speaking of the workers' bomb, though, I did get a coronavirus tweet retweeted by the Workers' Party of Great Britain. They're more like the workers' rocket.
Do you know, there's an interesting thing about the Workers' Party of Great Britain / George Galloway. You know, it should be like that. You know, like Marxist-Leninist.
Yeah, that's what it is. GG. It's just like GG.
Yeah.
The Workers' Party of Great Britain, GG.
It saved me from my conscience, right? Mm-hmm. So one of the things we've wanted to do on this podcast for a while is read a politician's shit novel, right?
It's not Jeffrey Archer.
And I thought I've got the fucking perfect one when I found out that George Galloway had written a novel, right?
Now, David, I've got to ask you this. Is it a novel or is it a novelette?
Well, so when Queensway by George Galloway arrived, right, I felt like a fucking dick, right? Here it is.
Okay, and so you're holding this up, like, for those of listeners who are not on YouTube. David is showing me the front cover of George Galloway, Queensway. I'm not drawn in as I literally judge this book by its cover.
Yeah, so on the front cover is, I believe that's a famous photograph of Hitler and his various lieutenants walking through Paris, occupied Paris. But, it's Big Ben in the background. Yeah. It's not the Eiffel Tower. So obviously, this is a novel on the completely original premise that Britain has been occupied by the Nazis, because no one has ever done this before, right? But when the book came in, I looked at the front cover, which is designed by George Galloway's wife, right? And it's a bit, you can't really see it here, but it's a bit grainy and so on, right? And I looked at how slim it was. Right?
It's slim.
It's slim, right?
Show us the margins and the size of font.
And as you can see here, the text is
double spacing.
The text is very large. Basically, it looks like, do you know what? The text is bigger and the book is shorter than like young adult fiction. You know, the Twilight books, they're denser than this. Do you know what I mean? Like something that's designed for a kind of teenager. And it has that. I mean, this isn't so much 13 to 15 as sort of 9 to 12, right? Now, see, this is the thing. And as soon as I started thinking all this kind of stuff, I thought, you know, I'm a fucking dick. Do you know what I mean? Because here's this lovely old guy who's a World War II enthusiast, as many of his generation are, And he's written this little novella about the, you know, occupation of Britain. And here I come in, like, do you know what I mean? I'm like the worst sort of just PMC. So, oh my God, is this your literary effort, George Galloway? Like a fucking dick, right? And I don't want people to think, like, I want to make this clear. I'm going to read this book. I haven't read Crime and Punishment. So before I get up on my high horse about the literary fucking merits of George Galloway, I am not, like, I will die one day having not read most of the classics. And one of those classics won't have been read because I was reading Queensway by George Galloway, right? So I'm in no position to look down on anyone, right? But then George Galloway's latest invasion into Scotland started to unravel itself, and I rapidly felt less sympathetic.
I mean, if anyone who is listening has not seen the Workers' Party of Great Britain Twitter, then I fully recommend that you have a look. I wouldn't say follow, but I would say definitely have a look. They've got some quite weird and wonderful insights. I'm trying to find my favorite one, which, it's rabidly right wing.
It's
very anti-independence, which is to be expected. I mean, their handle is Alliance for Unity, isn't it?
Alliance for Unity, yeah. So that's the thing they've set up in Scotland. Yeah. It's a very strange setup.
Their pinned tweet until very recently was something like SNP currency plans, the gyro.
So right, you know, obviously Galloway is like, his strategy is he's like a communitarian. So he goes into an area and he he tries to use local grievances amongst various communities to advance his political position. It's a complex one. I don't know that there's ever no kind of political belief involved in it. I'm sure he genuinely opposed the Iraq War and the Afghanistan War and so on. And so for a time, this is a tactic that worked very well for him among large anti-war communities, it has to be said. But it is true that he did appeal to Muslim communities and so on, and try and build a base around that. And by the way, I don't think that's a bad thing. I don't think it's a bad thing that people appeal to quote unquote the Muslim vote as though that's a real thing, and as though Muslim votes aren't as valuable as everyone else's vote, right? I think it's important to say that.
I mean, it's a more legitimate community than talking about specific areas where people are completely transient. Do you know what I mean? Like saints, yeah, and things
absolutely,
like that.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I kind of resent this thing of every time like George Galloway would win somewhere like Radford or people like that, well, it was the Muslim vote that won it for him, as though that means, well, therefore it's bullshit.
Somehow invalid. I mean, nonsense.
They live there.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Then he came, if you remember, he came to Scotland about 10 years ago, not quite 10 years ago. And he tried to reconnect with a kind of Irish Catholic communitarian vote, and bear in mind as well, these votes partially only exist in George Galloway's mind, which was kind of borne out in that election. I remember he was sort of handing out leaflets that said "Hail, Hail" on them, and talked about his sort of, you know, how he had a Catholic upbringing and he supported Celtic and all this kind of stuff. That didn't work for him at all because he has lost organic roots in Scotland among that community. Which he does, of course, come from in Dundee. So now, what's the sort of communitarian identity he sees himself as trying to attach himself to? It's the sort of unionist Protestant vote, as he understands it in his mind, which you could say is quite a turnaround, right?
It's definitely a flip.
Yeah, I mean,
180.
So he's now appealing to a kind of cartoonish vision of what that vote is in his mind, with stuff like that weird shit about how children in Scottish schools are being taught about anal sex and rimming, which, you know, that word is not a word I ever wanted to hear from George Galloway.
Anal sex, yeah. They're being taught about anal sex and rimming through, yes, the use of...
Nutella.
Nutella and
A banana.
Bananas.
Right. I don't believe that. But
it's a piece of nonsense.
But he seems to think that there's this kind of, he's trying to connect with a kind of social conservative audience, right? The leader of Alliance for Unity is like a high Tory landlord from the borders.
Was there not a woman that's like a real Islamophobe?
I wouldn't be shocked. I think there is a candidate who had said some Islamophobe, which is just sad when you consider the profile he's built elsewhere.
Like some of like the things that Galloway has done, I say, is like, you know, I do find him compelling, even if dislikable, which I think you share. But the most important things he's done has been around like anti-imperialism. Do you know what I mean? And I think that that's to be respected. I mean, we were talking the other night about like actually anti-imperialism is the big dividing line for a lot of us on the left.
Definitely.
And that's what Galloway should, if he's to be applauded for, is certainly his stance on that and his stances around Islamophobia and things like that. So for him to end up in a political alliance with out and out racists is just,
it's fucking tatty and sad.
It's sadder than Queensway.
So yeah, that kind of cheered me up a bit. I thought, this is the lowest behavior I've ever seen from him. Do you know what I mean? But I mean, the book is, I mean, I've read a couple of reviews of it, and you know, the literary merits are there. There are sex scenes.
Tell me that phrase again. What's the phrase he uses in the sex scenes?
I understand that in one scene, a woman who I think is a Nazi secretary is deemed is deemed only worth a bit of mouth relief.
It's so awful.
I can't wait to read it. I think it's also like, it's quite Partridge-esque in some places. Like there'll be the juxtaposition of a horrible Nazi crime with a little joke. Do you know what I mean? The stuff like that in it. So I'm looking forward to reading Queensway. And what I didn't show you, and what people listening to the podcast can't see, is this signature.
Oh, it's a signed copy. Oh, that page is an absolute... Shows it again. What font is that?
There's about 10 different fonts on the front page.
Definitely at least 5 different sizes of font. But it is a signed copy. It might be worth something one day.
Yeah, I got this for $4.99 from his website. So... Or I think it was like an Amazon kind of like link to his website or something like that. Can I just read a bit of the blurb, right?
Please.
So, June 1940, London has fallen. The Dunkirk evacuation has failed and only a few divisions have escaped. While 300,000 of their comrades remain trapped in France, there's already notes here of something that I've noticed flipping through the book. Pointless detail. This is a blurb. You don't need to mention divisions and hundreds of thousands of troops, right? But do you know what? I'm getting ahead of myself, right? Britain's military command has betrayed the troops and the people, turning to Hitler and the Axis powers. That's a bit spicy. A lightning invasion by Germany has captured London and much of the south of England. Winston Churchill is missing. Winston Churchill is a hero of George Galloway. Winston Churchill is missing, presumed dead, but the resistance is alive and, as he promised, will never surrender. This is Queensway, the first in a series of riveting and page-burning novels by George Galloway. Now,
tell me about page-burning.
There are two possibilities here. Both bad. One is that this is a typo on the short blurb on the back of the book. And the other possibility is that this is a joke about Nazi book burning. So yes.
What would you prefer if you had to choose?
Oh, the latter. If I thought it was a feeble pun about the Nazi book burning kind of rallies and stuff. I understand there is stuff like that in here, so
yeah.
We
need to do a special edition.
Yeah, I think so. I think so.
But we won't actually have a pod for another 2 weeks, so this is kind of...
It's a stopgap pod, though, because we are planning some mystery guests, none of whom we're going to announce because we haven't confirmed them yet. But, yeah.
I mean, tweet us your guests, like your dream guests. You know, if listeners want to get in touch with us, suggesting that we invite someone on the pod. What I will say is David is aware of who my dream guest is to come on the pod. He's forgotten already.
Oh no, you mean the one when we discussed last night?
Oh, aye.
That would be interesting.
Yeah, some hot guests on. Not necessarily people that we would agree with on everything, but definitely people that we could have a good, deep discussion with. Maybe we should get George on, except neither of us can contact him because we are blocked.
Yeah, we're both blocked.
Sad.
But I mean, would you have George Galloway on?
Yeah.
It would be really strange.
Would you not want to ask him, like...
Definitely.
What's going on?
I'd be interested, but I think what you'd find is it'd be a bit like one of his shows where he just shouts over you. I think we'd get shouted at a lot.
But if we were doing it on Zoom, we could always mute him.
Yeah,
we need... At least be good entertainment value.
We need the control of that button, because he has it on his like radio shows and stuff. He's always muting, various to interject. So if we had that, yeah.
Who's your dream guest? George.
This is the thing though. It almost certainly wouldn't be someone I agree with in politics. Yeah. Like, I have no more questions to ask in many ways, like people who with whom I kind of agree on a lot of stuff. It would be someone, I mean, I often I'm sad about the lack of, like, there's not a right-wing intellectual in Scotland. There isn't. I mean, there isn't one. I mean, you could say there are Scottish intellectuals who've run away elsewhere. You know, Neil Ferguson, arguably, but like a lot of these people go to London or New York or whatever, the famous Scottish brain drain. But there isn't a serious right-wing political thinker or force or, you know, even academic in Scotland. It really is.
There's no good adversaries.
No.
Like that, I find that quite depressing.
There is a huge, huge area of liberal opinion, unreconstructed liberal opinion that spans the entire political spectrum in Scotland. We have a parliament with six liberal parties in it, with a few interesting personalities. So it is hard to say. In a kind of fucked up way, right, even though the George Galloway carnival as it rolls into town is mental, I think part of the reason people get into it so much is because he has so much more personality than Scottish politics, period. Mm-hmm. Which, you know, isn't that a good reason to... Because he sometimes says that. He sometimes says, I mean, it liven the place up a bit, the Scottish Parliament. It would.
Like, I mean, spot the lie.
Yeah, it would. And, you know, I mean, you could end up with the Parliament in 2021 with Rev Stu in it, because he still, I think, might run a party. George Galloway, locking horns.
But it will also lose some excellent characters.
Yeah. Alex Neil is on the way out.
Neil Finlay. Sandra White.
It
sounds like we're doing a sort of a united front and cuts rally.
Yeah. It sounds like we're announcing the lineup for an anti-cuts rally circa 2009. What that sounds like. Yeah. And on the platform today we have, roll call.
Yeah, so tweet us with any suggestions, or, you know, feel free to DM. DMs are open, as they say. Yeah, with suggestions for guests on the pod. Like we say, it doesn't have to necessarily be people that we agree with, but I think it would be interesting to explore some ideas.
So I, and if I'm wrong, by the way, about there being no interesting right-wing thinkers in Scotland, please do set me right so that we can have an argument with them.
Yeah.
Because that would be very interesting.
Yeah. A political argument, not a personal argument. Because remember, the political is political.
Oh, yeah.
And that's the tagline for this pod. And all of our pods forevermore.
Indeed.
Okay, so that's done.
That is us.
Okay. Remember, you can hear old episodes of ContourCast on Spotify, iTunes. We've got some episodes on YouTube. You can find out more about the Contour project at contour.co.uk. Anything else?
That is all, I believe. I'm away for a little while, but that doesn't mean you can't.
You're away on holiday, and I can tell that you've already sort of checked out.
I'm already walking in the Highlands, yeah.
Okay, well, see you in a couple of weeks.
See you soon.